بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسولنا وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه. اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا وزدنا علما. يا رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. أما بعد, So we begin inshallah with the explanation of النظم الصغير من مختصر التحرير للشيخ عامر بهجت حفظه الله. And this book, it's taken in its asl from مختصر التحرير by Ibn Najjar, as will come when the Shaykh mentions it, inshallah. نعم, اقرأ.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم من مختصر التحرير. أحمد ربي واهب العقول وصلي يا ربي على الرسول واكتب قبول نظمي الصغير فأصله مختصر التحرير إذ منه لخصت بلا تبويب رتبته بنمط قريب.
Okay, so this is the Muqaddimah. It says, أحمد ربي واهب العقول. I praise Allah, my Lord, واهب العقول. واهب يعني معطي العقول, the one who gives العقول, which is intellects. And this is a form of براءة الاستهلال, because it's mentioning العقل in the beginning is مناسب, since it's suitable, because علم الأصول, رسول الفقه, it relates to and إعمال الفكر, to use one's intellect and derive rulings through that. He said, وصلي يا ربي على رسول, and this is السلام على الصلاة والسلام على رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. And he said, واكتب قبول نظمي الصغير. This is dua, ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to write for him, or write for his nazm, his poem, قبول, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives it acceptance and makes it one which people benefit from. وَكْتُبْ قَبُولَ النَّظْمِ الصَّغِيرِ. And this is, as it says after that, وَكْتُبْ قَبُولَ النَّظْمِ الصَّغِيرِ كَأَصْلِهِ مُخْتَصَرِ التَّحْرِيرِ. Like how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wrote قبول for its asl, the book which is taken from, which is مُخْتَصَرِ التَّحْرِيرِ. Then he said, إِذْ مِنْهُ لَخَصْتُ بِلَا تَبْوِيبِ رَتَّبْتُهُ بِنَمَطٍ قَرِيبِ. Because إِذْ مِنْهُ لَخَصْتُ, I have summarized it from that, يعني from مُخْتَصَرْ تَحْرِير by Ibn Najjar al-Futuhi. رَتَّبْتُهُ بِلَا تَبْوِيبِ, meaning the poem here is not organized according to sections, abwab, chapters, rather it's all linked one to the other. Yes, لَخَصَ, to summarize. تَلْخِيص is summarization. رَتَّبْتُهُ بِنَمَطٍ قَرِيبِ, I have organized it بِنَمَطٍ, on a pattern, قَرِيب, يعني قَرِيب الْفَهْم, which is close to one's understanding, as in it's easy to follow and easy to understand. And like I said, the asal of this book is from مُخْتَصَرِ التَّحْرِير by Ibn Najjar. And مُخْتَصَرِ التَّحْرِير, it's taken in its asal from التحرير by المردوي. التحرير is a book in أصول الفقه written by علاؤدين المردوي from the حنابلة, which he took as a basis, أصول الفقه by Ibn Muflih as a basis on which he developed and added things and wrote التحرير. And then التحرير was summarized into مختصر التحرير by Ibn Najjar, and then مُخْتَصَرِ التَّحْرِيرِ is now here, summarized a lot into this nazm, and nazm al-saghir. Though it's not a complete summarizing of the book, rather it's taking aspects of it and leaving off others, because مُخْتَصَرِ التَّحْرِيرِ is a big book. Now, after that, the Shaykh is going to mention the categories of usul al-fiqh. And he did not give the definition of usul al-fiqh, but we will give that inshallah. Usul al-fiqh, it is al-qawa'id allati yutawassalu biha ila ma'rifati al-ahkam al-shar'iyyah al-far'iyyah bil-fi'li aw bil-quwwati al-qariba. This is the definition given in Mukhtasar Tahrir. It is al-qawa'id, the principles, allati, the ones, yutawassalu biha, by which it's reached, what is reached, yutawassalu biha ila ma'rifati الأحكام الشرعية الفرعية by which it's reached the knowledge of the أحكام يعني the rulings الشرعية the rulings relating to the Sharia الفرعية الفرعية meaning the ones which relate to أعمال المكلفين the actions of the humans actions of the slaves this is بخلاف the ones which relate to عقيدة the ones which relate to عقيدة are not from فقه so they are not from أصول الفقه so this is الأحكام الشرعية الفرعية الفرعية as in the ones which relate to actions of the عباد صلاة زكاة تجارة يعني بيع شراء نكاح and so on بالفعل أو بالقوة القريبة بالفعل meaning that the مجتهد the scholar he reaches these معرفة الأحكام يعني he reaches knowledge of these rulings بالفعل يعني in actuality by deriving the rulings أو بالقوة القوة القريبة meaning that even if the alim the mujtahid has not researched the issue and he has not reached a conclusion but he has the ability to do so then this is also fiqh and thereby this also applies in usul al-fiqh القوة القريبة القوة
So if he's not able to make an actual ruling like from the qawaid.
If he doesn't have a malaka, as will come at the end, the shurut al-mujtahid in the last section, if he doesn't have the malaka, the ability to derive rulings, then he is not a mujtahid, and therefore his knowledge is not considered fiqh. Fiqh is the knowledge of a person who knows, yani another definition which is given is ma'rifatul ahkam al-shar'iyya al-far'iyya min adillatiha al-tafsiliyya, to know the rulings of the yani fiqh rulings from its detailed evidences. So if a person doesn't know the evidences and isn't able to derive the rulings from it, then he's not a mujtahid and his knowledge of it is not called fiqh. Even though this is yani speaking about the technical terminology, al-istilah. Though it's fiqh in a linguistic sense because he has understanding. Like al-muqallid, a person who is not a scholar, not a mujtahid, and he asks an alim and the alim says that this thing is haram and he might even give an evidence. But this muqallid, this person who is taking the fatwa of the alim, he doesn't know how did he extract this ruling, how is this ruling extracted, what's the evidences, what are any opposing evidences. So here, his knowledge of this ruling is not considered fiqh. It's considered fiqh in a linguistic sense, but not in a istilahi sense. Fiqh in the linguistic sense, it means al-fahm. Knowledge, yani, to have understanding. Now, so that's what usul al-fiqh is. Now, the Shaykh will mention the categories of usul al-fiqh. Okay. Ilmu al-usuli arba'un. Usul al-fiqh is divided into four sections. The first is al-ahkam. The second, الدليل أربع أحكام أدلة which is يعني الدليل دلالة that's the third and the fourth is الحكام يعني المجتهد so the first is الأحكام relating to the rulings is something halal is it haram مباح مكروه مستحب is this a شرط a condition is it a مانع a preventative and so on these are الأحكام which we'll come to and explain its types. The second is al-adilla or al-dalil, the evidences. What are the evidences from which rulings are derived? Al-Qur'an, al-Sunnah, al-Ijma', al-Qiyas, and other evidences. Then the third is al-dalala. Al-dalala meaning we now know the evidences, like we know we have this ayah, but how do we take understanding from this ayah? What's its dalala? Yani what does this ayah indicate? How do we know what it indicates? Is this ayah am, general, or is it khas, specific? Is it mutlaq, unrestricted, muqayyid, restricted? Is it amr, command? Is it nahi, forbidding? This is a dalala, yani what the evidences indicate. And the fourth is Al-Hukam. This is yani Mabahith Al-Mujtahid, the Masail relating to the Mujtahid, the one who is able to derive the rulings. What are its condition? What are the conditions relating to Mujtahid? What is done when there's yani Ta'arud Al-Dalilain, two evidences apparently opposing each other, how to combine and things like that, At-Tarjih and so on. That's all relating to the fourth section, which is Al-Hukam. Now, so starting with the first, he says,
فالأول الأحكام في قسمين تكليف أو وضع بغير ميل. أما التكاليف ففرض سنة ففرض
سنة
ففرض سنة إباحة كراهة وحرمة.
نعم. Okay. So first section is الحكم, الأحكام. What does الحكم mean? It means مقتضى خطاب الشرع. مقتضى خطاب الشرع, or some say مدلول خطاب الشرع. What the خطاب الشرع, يعني the command or the what's the English word for خطاب, يعني what the yeah the addressing of the Sharia, what it necessitates. That is الحكم. يعني when Allah سبحانه وتعالى says أقيم الصلاة, this يعني it's addressing the مكلفين, the people who are obligated to do acts of worship. So, for example, the ayah أقيموا الصلاة, this is خطاب الشرع. This is the address of the Sharia to the slaves, to the humans. What is the مدلول or the مقتضى of this خطاب الشرع? What does this ayah necessitate? It necessitates وجوب الصلاة, the obligation of salah. So this thing which is necessitated, it is called al-hukm, which is muqtada khitab al-shara. Now, and this is two types. Al-hukm, it is either hukm taklifi or hukm wad'i. So it says فالأول الأحكام في قسمين تكليف أو وضع. So the first, which is الأحكام, في قسمين, in two parts. التكليف يعني الأحكام التكليفية, and the second is الأحكام الوضعية. So, and it says بغير ميل, يعني without doubt. ميل is a shak يعني. No. So the first is what is الأحكام التكليفية and what is الأحكام الشرعية. الأحكام التكليفية هي التي تتعلق بأفعال المكلفين. Yes, the حكم التكليفي, it is the one which يتعلق بأفعال المكلفين. باقتضاء أو تخيير. يعني either it's necessitating one thing or another, or it's giving a تخيير, a choice. So that is what الحكم التكليفي is. As for الأحكام الوضعي, then they are not ones which relate to the rulings of the action of a person. Because when you say, for example, as-salatu wajibah, salah is obligatory. This is a hukm which is taklifi, because it relates to the actions of the ibad. If we say, al-maysir is haram, meaning gambling is haram, this is relating to al-ahkam al-taklifiyah, the actions of the actions of the slaves. Al-ahkam al-wad'iyyah, بالاقتضاء أو التخيير. الاقتضاء meaning that it necessitates one thing, either necessitates that you do something or you leave something off, or it's التخيير, يعني giving the person the choice, you can either do it or not, like something which is مباح, أكل التفاح مباح, eating an apple is permissible. this is a hukm, and it's a hukm taklifi. But the obligation, is there an obligation here? No. Is there a prohibition? No, this is at-takhir, yani giving the person a choice, which is al-ibaha, which will come to each of the al-ahkam al-taklifiyya. As for al-ahkam al-wad'iyya, so al-ahkam al-wad'iyya is kharab, it's the definition given in Mukhtasar al-Tahrir and other places, khabarun yustafadu minhu nasbu al-shari'i ala man mu'arifan li-hukmihi. It is a khabar, yani information, yustafadu minhu, from which a person, yani it's benefited or it's known from it, nasbu shari'i, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, shari'i, yani is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, has placed a nasab shay, yani to place something, nasbu shari'i, alaman, has placed a sign, mu'arifan li hukmihi, has placed a sign, which informs us of the hukm of the thing. And it's li hukmihi is not necessary, it's not necessary that it has to relate to the hukm of, it's not relating to the hukm of the action itself, whether it's halal or not. It's hukm of the, it's related to the hukm of the action or the thing in another sense, whether, for example, it's wujud, present, adam, where it doesn't exist, whether it's a cause, a sabab, or a mani, or a preventive, and so on. This is what's relating to, not relating to whether it's permissible or not permissible. Anyway, so the first is,
well, it's just the wisdom behind the actual.
Not a wisdom. For example, when we come to ahkam al-wad'iyya, for example, we say that something is a sabab. Sabab is a hukm wad'i. What does sabab mean? It is ma yalzamu min wujudihi al-wujud, as we will come. When one thing is existing, yalzamu min wujudihi, this thing being present for this existing, it necessitates wujud al-musabab. It necessitates the existence or the presence of the other thing. So this is called a sabab. And this is a hukm wad'i. As in, Allah, what does wad'i mean? You need to place. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or the shari' has placed here this hukm, which is the, has placed this sign, this alam, which is the sabab, as a sign to show the presence of another thing. To show the presence of, for example, time of salah. If we say, zawalu shamsi sababun lidukhuli waqti salat al-dhuhr, when there's zawal al-shams, when the sun goes past the zenith, then this is a sabab for, it's a cause for the entering of the time of dhuhr. So this is, it's entering the entering of the time of the time of dhuhr, something which is haram or wajib or mubah. No, it's not. Rather, it's something which is either present or not present, or it's other than that. Yani. It's wasfuhu, yani what's its...
Can you give me an example of that from the Quran?
These are ahkam. These are ahkam, yani they're derived from the Quran, and they're derived from the Sunnah. Mm-hmm. Not that the Sunnah will say that this thing is a sabab for something. Just how the Quran usually doesn't say that something is wajib, or the Quran doesn't usually say that it's wajib or it's haram. Yeah, so this ayah, for example, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا إِنَّمَا الْخَمْرُ وَالْمَيْسِرُ وَالْأَنْصَابُ وَالْأَزْلَامُ رِجْسٌ مِنْ عَمَلِ الشَّيْطَانِ فَاجْتَنِبُوهُ. Does this ayah say that khamr and maysir and these things are haram? It doesn't say that, right? But it says فَاجْتَنِبُوهُ, leave it off. So from this ayah, it's understood that the hukm is الْخَمْرُ حَرَام وَالْمَيْسِرُ حَرَام وَالْأَزْلَامُ حَرَام. So it shows that this thing is haram based on the understanding of the ayah. So the same thing, for example, أحكام الوضعية. If something is a cause or a mani', for example, it says in the Quran, وَإِذَا ضَرَبْتُمْ فِي الْأَرْضِ فَلَيْسَ عَلَيْكُمْ جِنَاحٌ أَن تَقْصُرُوا مِنَ الصَّلَاةِ إِنْ خِفْتُمْ أَن يَفْتِنَكُمُ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا. And when you travel in the earth, then there's nothing preventing you, there's no harm in you shortening the salah. So that means الضرب في الأرض, يعني a safar, traveling is a sabab, it's a cause for al-qasr, for shortening the salah. So that's al-ahkam al-wadhiyya. And you start relating to whether, what's the hukm of the action itself, whether it's haram or haram, halal or whatnot. It's whether that thing is mawjood or ghayr mawjood, present or not present, or similar to that. Now,
خبر سوء
when we come
خبر
to it, then we'll be explaining more. Yes, what were you saying? خبر.
خبر سوء is a it's like something so we're told something is we're told something let's say by Allah or Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam
yes
that the benefit that we take from it is that Allah put down
yes
the
so for example this is a khabar and it's not an amr it's not an insha when Allah Subhanahu Wa Taala says for example in the time of that shortening the salah that traveling is the sabab a cause for shortening the salah is Allah Subhanahu Wa Taala giving us an amr or a nahi commanding us to shorten or not shorten no rather it's khabar it's informing us that this is a cause for that or that a hadith where the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam says about the time of the salawat says that the time of fajr is this and that and the time of dhuhr and this and that is this saying that you should pray the salah no
so
it's
the
saying
alam,
the alam here it is the for example for the time of dhuhr the sun going past the zenith this is the alam this is the sign and the hukm is دخول وقت وقت الظهر yes yes and we'll explain it more when you get to الأحكام الوضعية إن شاء الله so the first says فالأول الأحكام في قسمين تكليف ووضع بغير مين أما التكاليف ففرض سنة إباحة كراهة وحرمة the أحكام تكليفية are five الفرض also known as al-wajib, something which is obligatory. Second is sunnah, also known as mustahab, and also known as mandub. These are all names for the same thing, yani recommended. The third is al-ibaha, yani also known as al-halal, yani something which is permissible. And the fourth is أمل تكاليف فرض سنة إباحة كراهة الكراهة something which is disliked and the last is حرمة something which is حرام نعم now each one he will explain in detail what the ruling is for نعم So the first is this.
ما كان مأمورا فيه فهو إن كان جازما وإلا مستحب.
نعم. It says ما كان مأمورا به فذا وجب إن كان جازما وإلا مستحب. So it says ما كان مأمورا so this the first part it says فذا وجب يعني that is the wajib. What is the wajib? ما كان مأمورا به على وجه الجزم يعني it is ما أمر به على وجه الجزم that's one definition given and we'll give another definition after inshallah what does this mean? It is الأمر بشيء على وجه الجزم You are commanded to do something, yani bil jazm, yani 100%, yes. Al jazm is, yani there's no choice in it, it's complete, it's absolute. So this is fada wajib, that is al wajib, and also called al fard. And in the madhab, according to the jumhur of the ulama, the Hanabila, and the Shafi'iyya, and the Malikiyya, there's no difference between al fard and al wajib. Al fard and wajib both mean the same thing. Which is something which is ما أمر به على وجه الجزم. A person is commanded to do it without any a choice. As for the Hanafiya, then they differentiate between al-wajib and al-fard. And they say al-fard is something which the ruling of it is known by a dalil which is mutawatir. And as for al-wajib, it's known by something which the dalil for it is ahad. And we'll come to what al-mutawatir and al-ahad means when speaking about al-sunnah. Now, so that's al-wajib. Then it said, ما كان مأموراً به فذا وجب إن كان جازماً وإلا مستحب. يعني إذا لم يكن جازماً فهو مستحب. يعني المستحب, it is ما أمر به يعني بغير جزم without
مستحب
being
سنة سيفة.
yes مستحب and sunnah and also called mandub these are all the same thing يعني you're commanded to do it but if you leave it off then there is no sin in doing that so you can say also for al-wajib it is ما يثاب على فعله ويعاقب على تركه what a person is rewarded for doing and punished for leaving off this is al-wajib نعم and as for المستحب it's ما يثاب على فعله ولا يعاقب على تركه which a person is rewarded for if they do it and they're not punished for if they don't do it if a person leaves off something which is mustahab recommended then there's no sin upon them يعني لا يذم على تركه a person is not criticized or يعني it's not something bad necessarily if they don't do it because it's mustahab recommended not wajib نعم after that
موسع مخير وما قدم كفاية وعكسها كل يجب
كل يجب
يجب
Okay, so now this is relating to al-wajib. There are different types of al-wujub. The first is al-muwassa', al-wajib al-muwassa'. What this means is it's muwassa' fi waqtihi meaning it's not necessary to do it at a specific time rather you have a long and extended period of time to do this action like a salawat for example salat al-dhuhr you have all the way from al-zawal from past midday until يعني بحسب الخلاف between the ulama up to for example the إذا كان ظل كل شيء مثله بعد ظل السوال which is what the majority of ulama says when a person's shadow is the same as itself plus the original length of the shadow at midday
so it's not just before Asr
that is before Asr that
no,
time is the
right.
entering of Asr
oh.
so this is but the difference between the ulama is when does Asr enter based on that they differ on when the Dhuhr ends with the Jumhur saying one thing and the Hanafi is saying something different على كل حال So, this is waqtun muwassa'. It's extended, meaning you can pray in the beginning of the time, or you can pray in the middle of the time, or you can pray in the end of the time. And in all cases, you have fulfilled the obligation. Naam. There's not a specific time we have to do it. As for the opposite of it, which is called al-wajib al-mudayyiq, المضيق it's when one which is done at a specific time and it does not go outside of this time such as a sawm fasting and you have to fast from the beginning from fajr all the way to maghrib there's no choice about it you can't fast a bit before that or a bit after that the time here is مضيق specific and restricted
مضيق
مضيق نعم No, مخير is something else that's going to be different. Yes, he does mention, but he said موسع, and the opposite of that is called المضيق. As for المخير, then this is different. This is a second type.
Well, when he says
in
the second beat, the second shot.
No. So it says موسع مخير وطلب كفاية وعكسها كل يجب. He is mentioning three different categories or categorizations of الواجب. الواجب can either be موسع or it can be مضيق and it can either be مخير or معين or it can be كفاية or فرض عين and so on نعم
مضيق
مضيق it is limited to a specific time So the time for an obligation, for a fard, it can either be يساوي الوجوب وقته, يعني the time which is necessary for the obligation to be fulfilled, it's equal to the time which is given to do it, then this is مضيق, يعني the time to fast is from Fajr and to Maghrib, and the time where it's valid is only from Fajr to Maghrib, يعني it's not bigger nor smaller. Or it's possible that the time needed to do the action لِأَدَاءِ الْفَرْضِ, it's less than the time which is given to do it, which is al-muwassa', such as the salawat. That is, the time to pray salah, it doesn't take all the time from Dhuhr to Asr. It only takes a small portion of that time. So this is muwassa'. And the opposite would be if the time needed to do an action, it was more than the time given. And this is muhal, something which is impossible. That, of course, that would be taklifu ma la yutaq, to obligate someone to do something which they are not able to. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, لا يكلف الله نفسا إلا وسعها. نعم. So that was the first type of categorization. The second is, it is either مخير or معين. What this means is, in some obligations, a person has to do a specific thing, which is the majority of obligation. So when you pray salah, you have to pray salah specific time and in specific amount. This is mu'ayyan. Anyway, you pray dhuhr, you have to pray 4 rakat. You don't have a choice to do something else. As for al-mukhayyar, it is the one where a person has a choice between several things. And you can do either this or that or that. The example of that being a person who breaks a yameen, an oath, kafar to the yameen. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فكفارته إطعام 10 مساكين من أوسط ما تطعمون أهليكم أو كسوتهم أو تحرير رقبة فمن لم يجد فصيام 3 أيام. Person has a choice to either feed 10 people, or to clothe 10 people, or to free a slave. So any of these you do, it fulfills the obligation. So if something is obligated, there is an obligation, but there is a choice in it, either this or that or that. So this is wujub mukhayyar. Now, so that was the second type of categorization for al-wajib. Al-wajib is either muwassa' or mudayyiq, or it's mukhayyar or mu'ayyan. And the third type is fardu aynin wa fardu kifayatin. So it says muwassa' mukhayyar wa ma talib kifayatin wa aksuhu kullun yajib. So it's either muwassa', which the opposite of it is mudayyiq, and it's either mukhayyar, or the opposite of it is mu'ayyan, or it's وَمَا طُلِبْ كِفَايَةً وَعَكْسُهُ كُلٌ يَجِبْ. So here, it's saying that there is an obligation which everyone has to do. This is فَرْضُ عَيْن. It's an obligation upon every person individually. Naam. So that's like Salah, Siyam, Hajj, Zakah, so on, Birrul Walidain. All of these obligations, you have to do them yourself. So it's Fardun ala alayka, yani mu'ayyan, on you specifically. And the opposite is Fardu Kifaya. Fardu kifaya, it's when a group of people have to do the obligation to fulfill it, and the rest are not then required to do it. So it is ma yasqutu bi fi'li ba'd an-nas 'an al-akharin. Ma yasqutu al-wujub bi fi'li ba'dihim 'an al-akharin.
لا يسقط
نعم. So So it's the opposite. So fardu kifaya is, for example, salatul janazah. If a person, if a Muslim dies, it's obligatory for them to be prayed upon. So for example, salatul janazah, if a Muslim dies and someone prays on him, then the obligation is fulfilled. And the obligation falls from the rest of the Muslims. But if no one prays on that Muslim, then everyone is sinful. Everyone who is able to and who did not fulfill the obligation, they are all sinful. So this is fardu kifaya. And there's many things which are fardu kifaya, such as, for example, hifdhu al-Qur'an, memorizing the Qur'an. Some Muslims are doing it, and this fulfills the obligation from the others. But if no one's doing it, then it's really sinful, because this will lead to bay'a al-deen for the yani ilm to be lost. Naam. So I said, Salah al-Azim said, مُوَسَّرًا مَخَيْرًا وَمَا طُلِبْ كِفَايَةً يعني وَمَا طُلِبْ كِفَايَةً بِالْكِفَايَةً يعني as a group. وعكسه كل يجب, and the opposite is فرض عين, which is كل يجب يعني يجب على كل شخص وحده. Then the next is اقرأ.
ما لا يتم واجب إلا به فواجب فاحرص على طلابه.
نعم. ما لا يتم واجب إلا به فواجب. Something which the person, he's obligated to do something, but he is not able to fulfill that obligation except by doing something else. ما لا يتم واجب إلا به. Then the hukum for this is فواجب. For example, let's say it's an obligation for you to pray salah, and it's an obligation for you to pray salah standing and in salat al-fard, but you're lying down. You are not able to fulfill this obligation of praying standing up unless you stand up. So if a person said to you, you need to stand up to pray your salah, you ask him, what's the dalil? Where does it say in the Quran and Sunnah that I have to stand up? Where does it say that standing up is obligatory, something which is wajib? We would say, ما لا يتم واجب إلا به فهو واجب. Whatever, a person is not able to fulfill something obligatory except by doing something else, then that thing, which is a means for it to be fulfilled, also becomes obligatory.
What do you still need to bring evidence that you can't fulfill it without standing, without standing?
Well, this is known by aql, by intellect. Of course, you can't pray standing unless you stand up. Or, for example, wujub al-hajj, you have the ability and everything to go to hajj, but, for example, your door is closed. Someone asks you, what's the obligation that I have to open my door to go outside? I'm not able to pray and go to hajj because the door is closed. They say it's obligatory for you to open the door. Even, for example, if the door is locked, and it would be obligatory for you to break that door and go, because hajj is obligatory upon you, wajib, and the only way you can do that is by breaking this door open. So here, ما لا يتم واجب إلا به فهو واجب. And this is different to ما لا يتم الوجوب إلا به فليس بواجب. This is, we were speaking about the case where the action is already obligatory upon you. Then, doing the things necessary in order to fulfill that action, even if those things are in the asl not wajib, that's if the thing is already obligatory. But what if the thing is not obligatory on you in the first place, such as giving zakah? Zakah is only obligatory if you have a specific amount of money, right? A specific amount of wealth, which is the nisab. So are you going to say then it's obligatory for you to make money and to earn money in order to reach the nisab so then you can give zakah? No, because this isn't ما لا يتم الواجب إلا به, because zakah is not wajib on you in this case. This is ما لا يتم الوجوب إلا به. The wujub, the obligation, isn't fulfilled, and it doesn't even become obligatory until a shart, the condition, is met. Such as in this case, having the nisab. Here, this is not wajib. Rather, this is mubah. Yani you can work in order to earn enough money to reach the nisab. And once you do, then zakah will become obligatory upon you. Or you can choose not to work and not to earn the money, and then the zakah would not be obligatory upon you. Likewise, a similar principle is ما لا يتم ترك الحرام إلا به فهو واجب. Or also you can say ما لا يتم ترك الحرام إلا بتركه فتركه واجب. Leaving off something which is haram is obligatory. And leaving off, if you are not able to leave off that haram thing except by leaving off something else which is mubah, then that thing which is mubah also becomes haram for you, because you are not able to leave off the haram except by leaving this thing off. And this yani comes under the same as the previous principle. So he said فَوَاجِبٌ فَحْرِصْ عَلَى طِلَابِهِ يعني strive in طلابه يعني طلبه أو مطالبته in fulfilling it. And this part was added in order to complete the bait from the شعر. فَحْرِصْ عَلَى طِلَابِهِ يعني strive in completing it or strive in doing it. Next.
من حرام فهو ما عنه نهي جزمًا ودون الجزم فعله الطهي.
نعم. أما الحرام فهو ما عنه نهي جزما. فالحرام something which is haram, it is ما نهي عنه على وجه الجزم. It's the opposite of الواجب. الواجب was ما أمر به على وجه الجزم. يعني الأمر as we know it is طلب فعل شيء, to do something. It's seeking that a person fulfills or does an action. And as for النهي, it is طلب ترك شيء, to seek that the person leaves off something, that they don't do something. So النهي الحرام is ما نهي عنه يعني ما طلب تركه. The person is commanded to not do something, to leave off something, على وجه الجزم يعني with certainty يعني absolutely, meaning if they do it then they are sinful. So you can also say that الحرام is ما يثاب على تركه ويعاقب على فعله. Person is rewarded for leaving off haram and they are punished for doing it. This is al-haram. Or you could say ما يذم فاعله مطلقا. The thing which a person they are criticized for unrestrictedly for doing it. Nah. And it's the opposite of wajib, yani ضد الواجب. And it's also called other names such as al-mahdhur. Mahdhur meaning يعني al-muharram, haram. And it's also called al-manhi anhu. But al-manhi, something which is forbidden, then this can also be makruh, يعني nahyu al-karaha as will come, or nahyu takrih, nahyu tahrim, or nahyu al-karaha. Now, the next is أما الحرام فهو ما عنه نهي جزما ودون الجزم فعله كراهي. ودون الجزم يعني without absoluteness, then this is المكروه. فعله كراهي, dislike its action. So المكروه, the one with the action which is hated or disliked, it is ما نهي عنه بغير جزم وما يطلب تركه بغير جزم. Person, they're commanded to leave off something, to not do something, but it's على وجه غير الجزم. It's not with absoluteness, meaning يثاب على تركه ولا يعاقب على فعله. It is something ما يثاب على تركه. The person is rewarded for leaving it off, for not doing it, ولا يعاقب على تركه, and they're not punished for doing it. So it says
وَإِنَّكَ التَّخْيِيرُ فَالْإِبَاحَةِ بِالْأَصْلِ أَوْ مَنَّ النَّصُّ قَدْ أَبَاحَ.
نعم. The next is الإباحة, which is وين التخيير, when the person has the choice. So المباح it is ما لا يطلب فعله ولا تركه, أو ما يستوي فيه فعله وتركه. Something in which it's equal, whether you do it or you don't do it, it's equal, يعني there's no difference. ما يستوي فيه الفعل والترك. Or you could say ما لا يثاب على فعله ولا يعاقب على تركه. Something which a person's not rewarded for doing, nor are they punished for leaving off. And this is called al-mubah. No. It's also referred to as halal. Halal usually refers to al-mubah. Naam, so those are the ahkam al-takleefiyya. Next is going to be al-ahkam al-wad'iyya. Naam. اقرأ. بالأصل أو من النص قد أباح. الإباحة, it is two types. The first is الإباحة بالأصل, which is called, it's also referred to as الاستصحاب. استصحاب الأصل. Or استصحاب will mention it later on, but you can just say, here you can mention it, or you can just write ما أبيح بالأصل. The أصل, الأصل في الأشياء, الحل. The أصل in things, it is that it's permissible. يعني مع التفصيل, of course, there's detail. الأصل في العبادات الحظر. When it comes to acts of worship, the أصل is that you don't do it unless the command يعني has come. And the أصل in...
So they're not... But they wouldn't even come under إباحة, صح?
Yeah, يعني عبادات don't come under إباحة. They'd either be مستحب or واجب. Also, in certain things, the أصل is not إباحة. For example, في البضع, in نكاح and things relating to sexual intercourse and things like that. The asal is that it's haram unless the dalil says that it's halal. And if, for example, you can't marry a woman unless it's specific. And the asal is if there's a woman you don't know, is this woman related to you or not related to you? Then here, you're not allowed to marry her because the asal is في الأنكحة التحريم. And it is something relating to fiqh, which...
It's not usul fiqh.
Huh?
That's not usul fiqh.
No, the asl in something is
as
usually
in,
referring to al-qawaid al-fiqhiyya.
You know how all of, so everything, every ibadah is haram, it will be halal.
Yes.
And every normal thing, like every mu'amirah is
yeah,
halal.
Halal to prove haram.
There's more to that then.
Yeah, there's slightly more tafsir in certain acts of, yani certain mu'amalat and certain ankiha and things like that.
The word that you said about al-wudah, is there a name for it? Like, is it just specifically wudah?
الأصل في البضع التحريم والأصل في الدماء التحريم and so on. Anyway, so the next is it says بالأصل أو من نص قد أباح. The thing, it's either مباح بالأصل or it's بالنص, something which is explicitly said in the Sharia to be halal, shown explicitly from a nas, the ayah or a hadith, that this thing is halal, permissible. No. So, the next is
وإن أحكام وضع سبب وعلة وشرط والموانع المقلة.
Now, so now al-ahkam al-wadiyya. We already mentioned the definition for al-ahkam al-wadiyya, and these are different types. The first is sabab. As-sababu. As-sababu is ma dalla wujudihi ala al-wujud. Well, each one is going to be said later on, so we'll just mention them. We'll list them out, then explain each one separately. So الأحكام الوضيعة السبب والعلة والشرط والمانع والرخصة والعزيمة والفساد والصحة. سلسلة أحكام وضع سبب وعلة، والشرط والموانع المخلة، ورخصة وعكسها العزيمة، ثم فساد صحة قويمة.
الشرط is رخصة.
سلسلة والشرط والموانع المخلة.
السبب علة، شرط خلاص.
المانع والرخصة والعزيمة والصحة والفساد. رخصة linguistically means يعني سهولة، something which is سهل، something which is easy. No. So each one now, the Sheikh is going to explain them.
فسبب دل على الوجود وفقده دل على الوقود.
نعم، السبب it is ما يلزم من وجوده الوجود ومن عدمه العدم. فالسبب دل على الوجود وفقده دل على الفقود. السبب when the سبب which is the cause is present هذا دل على الوجود. ما يلزم من وجوده الوجود يعني ما يلزم من وجوده يعني وجود السبب وجود المسبب the thing which is being caused. نعم. And the opposite is also true. It says ما يلزم من وجوده الوجود ويلزم من عدمه العدم. فسبب دل على الوجود وفقده دل على الفقود. And the وفقده يعني فقد السبب يعني عدم السبب. When the سبب is not present, the cause is not present, دل على الفقود. Then that necessitates that the مسبب, the thing being caused, is also not present. So, for example, وقت الظهر, the سبب for it is زوال الشمس, the sun going past the zenith, the midday. This سبب, when it's present, when this occurs, دل على المسبب. Then this necessitates the thing which is being caused, which is the entering of the time of ظهر. And the opposite is also true. When this has not happened, then مع عدمه, when it's not present, then also المسبب, the thing which is being caused by this سبب, is also not present, which is the entering of the time of الصلاة. The salah time cannot enter unless the سبب is present. So that is ما دل وجوده على الوجود وعدمه على عدم. نعم. Next.
وعدم الشرط يفيد العدم وجود مانع كذاك فعدم. وما به
So he said, ما دل وجوده على فالسبب دل على وجوده وفقده دل على الفقود وعدم الشرط يفيد العدم وجود مانع كذاك فعلمه. The next is الشرط. الشرط is known as ما يلزم من عدمه العدم ولا يلزم من وجوده الوجود. ما يلزم من عدمه يعني what necessitates in it not being present when the شرط is not present العدم. It necessitates that المشروط the thing which is this is a condition for it will not also not be present, such as الطهارة للصلاة purification. It is a شرط for the validity of صلاة. If the purification, if the طهارة is not present, then the صلاة cannot be present. يعني الصلاة is not valid. But if the purification is present, the person has wudu, does that mean that the salah is necessarily present? No, because the person might have wudu, but they might not be facing the qibla. ولا يلزم من وجوده الوجود. نعم.
بمعنى وجود يعني الحكم.
ها؟
بمعنى وجود يلزم وجود الحكم يعني.
نعم وجود المشروط. The thing which is this is a condition. الشرط والمشروط. The shart is the condition. والمشروط is the thing which this is a condition for. So that is الشرط. وعدم الشرط يفيد العدم. عدم الشرط, شرط not being present, يفيد العدم. It gives us the information that the مشروط, the thing which this is conditioned for, is also not present. وجود مانع كذاك فعلما. المانع, it is similar to the شرط, but the opposite, which is ما يلزم من وجوده العدم ولا يلزم من عدمه الوجود. So, for example, الحيض, menstruation, this is a مانع للصلاة. It is a preventative for the salah. Why? Because وجود الحيض, the presence of menstruation in a woman, يمنعُ الصلاة. It prevents the صلاة. يعني يلزم منه عدم الصلاة. It necessitates that the صلاة is not valid and it's not present. But the opposite is not true. Meaning, when it's not present, عدم الشرط, عدم المانع, لا يلزم منه وجود وجود الشيء. When the مانع is not present, for example, the woman is not on her menstruation, hayd is not present, but does that mean that her salah is present, her salah is valid? No, because perhaps the conditions are not met, perhaps the other other reasons could also be there for it not being valid. So it's ma yalzamu min wujudihi al-adam. When the mani' is present, it negates and it what's the word for it? Yabtud, yani yanqudu. It negates and invalidates the action, the hukm and the fi'l. But if it's not present, that doesn't mean that it's necessarily valid. وجود مانع كذاك فعلما. Next.
وما به ترتب المراد فصحة وضدها الفساد.
نعم. الصحة ما به ترتب المراد. ما يترتب عليه المراد من فعله. It's also said ترتب أثر مطلوب من فعل عليه. ما يترتب عليه المراد من فعله. What this means is, when there's an action being done, whatever hukum that is, whether it's ibadah or mu'amala or whatever it is, there's a murad, something which is intended, something which is a maqsood, the purpose of this action, the gharad. So in obligations, for example, the purpose is suqut al-wujub, so that the obligation falls from you and it's ada'u, to fulfill the obligation. This is the athar, the result which is matlub, which is sought. If this result is fulfilled and it's achieved, then this is as-siha, correctness in the action. يعني ترتب عليه المراد. So if you pray salah with all its conditions, all of the shurut are present, and the mawani are negated, the preventatives, then this is sahih. The salah is sahiha. There is siha in it, meaning what is intended from this salah, which is the obligation being fulfilled, has been complete.
So yatarattab is to be achieved.
Tarattab, yani it's based on, it's ordered, it's yatarattabu alayhi, yani it's يعني من الترتيب يعني it comes onto it, it comes after it. What's the English word for it? ترتب يعني it obligates or it causes يعني. And that's for ibadat. As for example, muamalat. In al-bay' or shira', when you're buying or selling something, al-bay', this selling of something, this aqd, the contract, what does it mean if the aqd is sahih? If there's siha in the aqd, validity, it means that al-athar al-matlub yatarattabu alayh, that the athar, the thing which is being sought, it occurs, which is intiqalu al-milkiya, for the ownership to go from me to you. This is what is being sought from this this act, this exchange, right? So if this is fulfilled, yani the milkiya, the ownership has moved from me to you, then that means that the contract, the act, was sahih. That's athar al-mutaratab alayhi. The opposite of that is وَمَا بِهِ تَرَتَبَ الْمُرَادُ فَصِحَةٌ وَضِدُّهَا الْفَسَادُ. الفساد, it is ما لا يترتب عليه الأثر المطلوب, which is what is being sought from this action, it does not occur. If you're praying salah and the salah is invalid because one of the conditions is missing, one of the shurut is missing, or if there's a mani or preventative and so on, then in this case the hukum is that the salah is fasid, fasida, invalid. What does it mean that it's invalid? The athar al-matlub, what was being sought from this salah, it has not been fulfilled, which is that the wujub has not befallen, it has not fallen off you, it has not been fulfilled, the wujub is still upon you, you still have to do the salah. There can be then for it if it's done yani intentionally, for example, leaving off a shart intentionally. But why, if it's done accidentally, you forgot that you didn't have wudu, then there's no sin, of course. But it's still fasid. Yes, so that is al-fasad in al-ibadat. Al-fasad in al-mu'amalat would be in a contract, for example, if it's in a bay' selling, if there's the contract is invalid, لا يترتب عليه المراد, meaning that the intiqal al-milkiyah, the exchange, the change of ownership from me to you, this does not occur. That means that the contract was fasid. And al-fasid and al-batil, according to the jumhur of the ulama, they mean the same thing. As for the Hanafiya, they differentiate between al-fasid wal-batil. So they say al-fasid is ma yumkinu tasheehu al-aqd, wal-batil is ma la yumkinu tasheehu al-aqd. So they say that al-fasid is something where it's in its asl, it's valid, but something has made it partially invalid, so that thing can be changed and then it will remain valid.
So for example, if you miss, let's say you miss the first attahiyat of your salah, and then you forget, so you didn't do, so actually you did do that, so you did the sahw.
No, this isn't fasad. Not according to any alim, because the salah is valid. يعني ترتب عليه الأثر, the wujub has before. But for example, in bay', if there's a contract, if a contract's being done, and this bay' is, it contains within it something which is haram, there's an aspect of it's haram, for example, there's jahala in it, or gharar, or something like that, then in such a case, the jumhur of the ulama would say that the contract in its asl is invalid, and you have to make a new contract and redo it in a proper way. As for the Hanafiya, say no, that is valid, and any condition or anything which is haram in it, that can be changed and removed, and the contract remains in its asl. And the jumhurus, they say that there's no difference between al-fasid and al-batil, except for in certain cases. For example, the Hanabila say that in an-kiha, in marriages, they differentiate between al-fasid al-batil. They say al-fasid, it is al-batil, it is a marriage which is invalid by ijma'. All ulama agree that this marriage is invalid, such as marrying one's sister or one's mother, or marrying for example, a woman who's already married. This is, of course, invalid by ijma'. And as for al-fasid, they say that's one which the Hanabila, they say that this contract is invalid, but other ulama say it's valid, such as, for example, the woman marrying off without her wali, without her male guardian given permission. So here, the Hanafiyyah say that the marriage is valid, whereas the Jumhur say that's invalid. So this sort of marriage would be called?
The Hanafiyyah say
it. They say it's valid. So this would be called, according to the Hanabila, fasid, and it would not be called batil.
Ala kulli hal. So when would it be batil for the Hanabila?
It would be something which all of them agree that this contract is invalid.
And fasid, it might not be...
Fasid is the one where there's khilaf between the ulama in this marriage. Is this marriage valid or not? Some of them say that it's a valid type of marriage, others say that it's not.
The one without the wali?
Yeah, for example, one without
so
the wali.
So the Hanabila say that it's valid or invalid?
They said this marriage is invalid.
The Hanafis say
yes,
valid.
But the Hanafis say it's valid. So because there's khilaf in this, then and the principle is that it's because there's khilaf, then the Hanabila they will accept this marriage to be valid, and they won't. Yani, what's necessitated from it being halal, from it being a valid marriage, it will occur as if it is, even though the Hanabila they think that this is not valid, but because they're taking an opinion of a different school of thought or a different scholar, then they act as if it is valid. Now, so this is.
Well, if and someone, let's say they're following this method, so they're following the Hanafiya in this regard, and that happens, that marriage, they leave this marriage with him, that's halal and everything.
That is valid for them.
There's no way that it's not valid. It's not valid. As in.
And
opinion,
in terms of.
Their opinion is.
Yeah, as it relates to the rulings regarding them, because this is a thing where there's khilaf in it. Then in such case, according to the ahkam, then it's halal, and it's permissible in their case. As for if they're doing it without actually taking this opinion, but following it for tatabu rukhas, to seek an easy opinion, fatwa shopping and things like that, then they would be sinful in the akhirah.
But is it valid?
As for in relates to the ahkam of dunya, it's valid. Now, so that was al-siha wal-fasad. The next is الرخصة والعزيمة. So he said وثابت على خلاف الأصلي
وثابت على خلاف الأصلي فرخصة وقيدا بالسهل والعلة الوصف الذي قد اقتضى حكم بهذا مبحث الحكم قضى.
The last thing is الرخصة, which is the opposite of العزيمة. الرخصة هو الحكم.
You say the last thing is الرخصة.
الرخصة والعزيمة. No, after that is العلة as well. So الرخصة is ما ثبت على خلاف الأصل لدليل معارض راجح. Something which is with the condition مع السهولة في الحكم, مع السهولة في الحكم.
ثبت على خلاف الأصل لدلال
لدليل خاص, or just say لدليل خاص به مع سهولة في الحكم. So, for example, the asl is that eating al-mayt, an animal which is not slaughtered, this is haram. But in the case of a necessity, then it becomes permissible. And this is called a rukhsa. Also, for example, the asl is that a person is supposed to wash their feet in wudu. But when a person has al-khuf or al-jawrab, according to the Hanabila, then they are allowed to wipe over them. This is khilaf al-asl. The asl is that you're supposed to wash it. But here, you didn't wash it, you wiped it. So this is al-rukhsa. And the condition is that it has to be waqayyidan bil-sahli. Al-rukhsa, it's only called al-rukhsa if the hukm is easier than the asl. If it's not easier, then it's not called al-rukhsa. So for example, wiping is easier than washing. And in a case where, for example, shortening, qasr al-salah, this is a rukhsa because it's easier than praying it in full. Now, and then the opposite of a rukhsa is al-azima, and al-azima it is ma kana ala al-asl fil-hukm. الحكم الثابت على الأصل which is where
So
which is
washing
the
the
major
feet.
yeah washing the feet praying the salah in full not eating الميتة all of these are العزيمة يعني the regular situation it is called العزيمة next اقرأ العلة this is والعلة الحكم التي قد والعلة الحكم الذي قد اقتضى والعلة الوصف الذي قد اقتضى حكما it is الوصف الذي يقتضي الحكم الشرعي الوصف الذي يقتضي الحكم الشرعي What this means, it is an attribute or a description which necessitates the hukm. Such as, for example, we know that alcohol is haram, khamr is haram. What is the reason for khamr being haram? It is al-iskar, that it intoxicates a person. So al-iskar, it is the quality, the attribute which has made this hukm which has made this thing haram. So this is the illah for the hukm. And this is قَدْ اِقْتَضَى الْحُكْمِ يعني it necessitates the hukm, even though in reality it's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's command which necessitates the hukm, but this is a sabb, yani a cause for it being necessitated, so that's why it is called that. Some ulama say that it's الْوَصْفُ الْمُعَرِّفِ بِالْحُكْمِ So the attribute which makes us know the ruling. Same thing that we know that alcohol is haram because of al-iskar, because of intoxication. The difference between some ulama, they don't differentiate between al-illah and sabab, and others do. The difference is that in al-illah, the munasaba is yudraku, yani yufham al-munasaba. The relation is understood. Why is, for example, alcohol, why is al-iskar intoxication an illah for alcohol being haram? The reason is because we know that it makes sense. Yani this masalikul illah which will come, how to derive the illah. But here there's yani a reason for it. As for a sabab, then it's something which seems yani to us arbitrary. Such as for example, dhuhr being in the zawal. Why isn't dhuhr at yani 12 o'clock every day? Why isn't it exactly at midday? Why is it at this time specifically? This is just a sabab, yani it's something which the Sharia has placed without necessarily yani being a reason for why it is. It's just, this is a sign for it. So the sabab, it's merely a sign, whereas an illah is a reason. So the ruling is because of the illah, min ajlihi. Whereas the sabab, it's just merely an alam or a yani dalil for the hukm, not a reason for it. بهذا مبحث الحكم قضاء. So that was the end of مبحث الحكم. So we spoke about the first section of أصول الفقه, which was الأحكام, and we discussed التكليفية والوضعية. The next section is now about الأدلة, أنواع الأدلة, the types of evidences in the Sharia.